If it needs a new charge. Or...
Let's charge it since we're not using it anymore. Thanks.
You have all my beverages here. Wow. This will be my little bar. So as you can see up on the screen, if you're done sharing our survey, you can see that there are, I can see all the responses that you've made. So this is a Google site that I've made, and this is a Google form that I've put on the Google site. And behind the Google form is this spreadsheet of all of the different things that you guys have responded to on the survey. So I can quickly see what are some of the things that you're expecting about for getting out of this workshop, some of the ways that you've used Google Apps in the classroom, so that I can really customize the hour and a half that we have together to make sure that we kind of capitalize on all the things that we want to. One of the things about a spreadsheet that you can do too is this little guy right here is a filter. So I used this same exact form for even the Google Sites people as well. So if I just wanted to see the YouTube people, I could click on this little filter, and then I have one of these drop-down menus that's now just recently appeared on my spreadsheet. And so I can click on the drop-down menu and say, I just want to see the people that say YouTube, and then I can see just the YouTube people. So it's kind of a fun way of capitalizing on what you've put in there. I can also do some conditional formatting, which I could do... If I could say that if, oh wait, let me just grab this column right here. This is the one that says 3, 4, 2, 3, you know, how you feel about it. If I go format and I do some conditional formatting, I could say if the text contains a 3, I want to turn the background red. And then I could save the rules. And now I can quickly glance at who's a 3. You know, and then I could say also with that same, so now I'm getting a good picture of what I have. I could also do some formatting that if the text contains a 1, I want to make it green and add another rule. If the text contains a 5, let's make it blue. So now I could get a good picture as to, oh, I forgot to do the entire column, so it didn't work, but then I could get a good picture of where I feel like people are with what they're learning how comfortable they feel with this. So it's sort of a good way that you could start thinking about using Google Forms sort of in the classroom as well. We are going to be talking about YouTube today. And one of the things that you're gonna need to do is you're gonna need to make sure that you're signed into your Google Apps for Education account. So how many of you have signed into your Google Apps account before? Okay. If you haven't, then there might be a few extra steps. But what you need to do is you need to go to the Google Apps sign-in page, which is on the Chaska page. You can just click there. And then remember, when you sign in, you have to do your username at isd112.org. Okay. So let's sign in to your Google Apps for Education account, because really from now on, I'm going to use my website as a resource. But you are going to need to sign it. So you should get to Google Drive once you sign in. Yep, right there, and then sign in.
You said it was our username.
Username and then at isd112.org. And then it should be your regular password, I believe. Mm-hmm.
click remember password?
Okay, now with your Google Apps for Education account, you have YouTube associated with it, but you might not have a channel set up. So that's what we're going to do as well. But first, let me just walk you through a little video that I made that'll sort of show you a few things that we might learn along the way. Okay, so we're not going to actually go into that video and watch that, but I wanted to watch you that's a video that I made and uploaded, I edited, and I made an annotation that links to another channel. Okay, so those are just some of the capabilities that you can start doing when you're using YouTube in the classroom. Now, 90% of conversations that you have with friends at some point have had you've said, have you seen the video? Right? Have you seen the video of Denver the dog? Have you seen Kane's Arcade? Have you seen Thumbs Up Everybody? Have you seen, all of this stuff? So here are, here's Felix, which I'm not sure if you've seen that, but this was a fantastic video. It's got like 29 million hits or something. So when you do a session on YouTube, you get to watch YouTube videos throughout it. So let's just watch. It's fun. So the thing I love about that video too, the story behind that one, is the thing he was most nervous about was the suit he was in. He felt sort of claustrophobic. I was like, or otherwise that you're jumping out of, into the stratosphere. So anyways, some videos are just captivating and they're just they're viral, right? So we talk about these viral videos, but more than just viral videos of people doing crazy things on YouTube is there's so much educational content in there, but sometimes it's just fun to watch a video. And sometimes it's just fun to incorporate a video into the classroom because there's no way you could teach about the solar system, or you could talk all about earth science, about Felix, right? So you bring Felix in and then you talk about why is the sky black, but when we look up, the sky's blue. What are some of the different stratosphere things that you saw within that? I mean, there's so many kind of ways that we can capitalize on a lot of the video that we can bring the outside world into our classroom by using video. So it's always fun to even have the kids share what some of their favorite videos are. Now, I have a little hashtag, NFS, not for school. There are definitely some videos that are not for school.
But there are a lot of great educational content videos out there. So I'm just going to fly through this really quick of 10 ways that you can use YouTube in your classroom, and then we're going to actually do a lot of them. So the first one is kind of the hooks and discussion starters. So like how you kick off any lesson. I mean, when we went to college and we learned about how to be a good teacher, we really talked about background knowledge. And, you know, some of our kids come in with an experience. Some of our kids don't have any idea what an experience is that we're talking about. But using YouTube, you can really kind of give the very same background knowledge or the same experience if you use a video to sort of intro some of the lessons that you have. So if you're talking about, volcanoes, I mean, this guy, watch this. We got an ad on this guy. Skip the video in 2 seconds. Baseball. Right, so this guy's at the volcano, at the edge of that. Again, people doing crazy things, right? Amazing. So using them for, you know, hooks and discussion starters is great. The next thing that we're going to do is we're going to talk about playlists. So you can start saving some of these videos that you like to use as a playlist, whether you have a magnetism and electricity playlist that the kids can play that are all about that content or curriculum area that you're studying, whether you have a playlist called Stupid Things People Do and Show on YouTube. You can have lots of different playlists, and there are playlists out there that are created for you. So you think of a playlist in the same way that we have them on our iPod, and that they're a list of things that are going to be all be playing together. So lots of great ways that you can make a playlist once you have a channel that you're going to create today. So channels and playlists, and I'll show you that. So it's a great place to archive your work. So what I'm doing right now, since all of you aren't able to come to each of the four sessions, we are screencasting or recording each of these sessions. And then what I'll do is I'll put them up on YouTube as a place that you could go back and you could look through the work, or you could revisit this session. You could watch another session that was happening that you weren't able to go to. So it's a great place to archive some of the hard work that you do, because inevitably you have a student that asks the questions about the same thing all the time, correct? Right? So that we can do that. So it's really great to save and archive our work. When we're archiving our work, a lot of times people are doing something called screencasting. And so they're recording their screen and their voice at the same time and then uploading them to YouTube. So it's a place that you can start creating your own content to put up on YouTube for your students to interact with, and we'll get to that a little bit. Obviously, extension opportunities in which students can go in and explore above and beyond what you're able to do in the classroom. They can choose different places that they go to. It's a great way to personalize your classroom. So when you're talking about personalized learning, or when you're talking about individualizing the learning, it doesn't matter. Every student doesn't have to learn the exact same thing on the same day. So whether we can provide extension opportunities or relearning opportunities, it's a great way that you can really kind of meet your kids right where they're at. A lot of people put YouTube videos up to review for different classroom tests or exams. Neither of these videos are showing right now. But it's definitely a way that you could start, you know, collaborating with different people to even do reviews for different assignments as well. It's also a great place to think of as a station. This is something that we kind of call YouTube homework, and the fact that you could just do it as one learning activity. It doesn't have to be something that you've created, but it could be a place that the students go to watch a video about something that's related to content that you're learning, whether you've created it or whether you have not created it too. And so then that gives you the ability to work with maybe a smaller group of students, give them background knowledge before coming to you to work at a certain spot as well. The ability, I'm going to show you today, is the fact that you can upload a YouTube video right from your from the webcam right onto your YouTube channel. So really thinking about making YouTube sub plans is kind of an easy way that the sub could just come in and just push play, and then it's you actually being there in your classroom, even though you're not there. You giving the directions and the instructions. So video messaging your students. And then once you're a real YouTube star teacher, you can start creating interactive videos like I did. So on the video that you saw me create at the beginning, there was a little link, a little speech bubble, and it said, click on this and it'll go to another YouTube channel. There are people that are out there that are making choose your own adventure or study exam YouTubes. So this one, this types of chemical reactions video right here, you watch the video, there's a question, it says click on the answer that you think. Is it synthesis? Is it that reaction? Is it double replacement or is it decomposition? And when you click on it, it takes you to a video that tells you if you're right or wrong. So it's a video choose your adventure. That we can wait for a little while if that's not something that you're ready to do. And then a lot of flipping your classroom, kind of giving the kids the ability to watch videos time and time again, providing direct instruction on YouTube so that you can have the students have the chance to rewind, replay a lot of the content that you need specifically for them for the learning. So just the direct instruction. So this is a great little YouTube video, and like I told you, because it's a YouTube session, we get to watch YouTube videos. So let's see if this guy will show up. You'll fall in love with this little guy. Has anybody seen this? Anybody know Rube Goldberg machines? Yep. Okay.
Thank you. If you don't succeed, try again.
Isn't he awesome? I know. So great, right? So lots of different ways that we can use YouTube in our classroom, not just, you know, watching YouTube videos. But what we're going to do is we're going to start by creating our channel. So I want to show you what that looks like first. And then we will go there together, and we're going to start getting hands-on. So when I go to YouTube, and I'm actually going to pop over into my apps account really quick. When you go to YouTube, up in the top right-hand corner, you're going to see either a sign-in box or you're going to see your name. So you can see that I'm signed in up in YouTube. That means that I've created my channel. And when I click on my name, I can see that I have my channel right here. Now, there's YouTube, of course, is always changing. People always ask me how I keep up with Google, and I always say, well, I just keep presenting on it, and when I present on it, something's changed, and so that's when I learn it, right in the middle of the presentation. So that'll probably happen today. But what we do is when you click on your name up here, it'll either be sign in or it will say that you have already created a channel. And then as we walk through that together, it might look a little bit different. My expectations are that it's either going to ask you to create your own channel name, okay, or it's going to ask you to use your real name. So why don't we all go to YouTube? So open up a new tab and just go to youtube.com. And this is great because in the back I get to watch. Now, some of you have it signed in the top right-hand corner. Some of you have a blue sign-in button. So click on the blue sign-in button if your name isn't already there. Okay? And then, yep, you can click OK to the security warning that comes up. And then put in your password again. Okay, if you get a little screen that's walking you through something, you could say at the bottom corner, next. Next. You don't have to pick any of this. Next. Save. Yep. Okay. So now you should get to a place that looks a lot like mine. Okay, where you have your name up in the top corner. You can close the ad. You have a yellow bar across the top that says this account is managed by ISD112.org, and that's fine. You can X out of that orange toolbar too if you want. Okay. Now it says congratulations, you've subscribed to 15 channels, and that means that they probably have channels that either they looked and they see what kind of videos you've been searching or whatever. But we're gonna subscribe to our own channels. So. This is now, what we need to do is we need to create your channel. So up in the top right-hand corner, click on your name. Click on your name, and then click on My Channel. Okay, this is what I was expecting. So now, up on your name, up in the top right-hand corner, yep, just your email address, sorry. Click on your email address. Okay, and then My Channel. The blue word, My Channel. And now it's asking you to set up your channel on YouTube. So this is how you're going to appear. And that's fine. Just choose your gender and your birthday. No, I think it's nobody else can see unless you put stuff on there that you want on there. Yes. But then whatever information you have on there, it's your school account, so there shouldn't be any personal stuff.
What about all those ads that appear in control?
Yep, that'll come through as well. Yep. Okay, so then you can click continue. Google may use my account information to personalize plus one. Yeah, uncheck that.
Oh.
It's not a big deal. Be warned. Yep, and then continue. Okay, so then this is your channel. And if you don't feel comfortable making your channel, nobody's telling you you have to have one. So it's just something that you get to play with.
I gotta tell you though, to be able to have playlists, it is amazing.
Yep. So you do have to have a channel in order to have playlists.
Okay. So what you should see is a black bar with your name on it once you've got your channel set up. The black bar with your name. Fantastic. Okay. Now you have a channel. Congratulations. Now this channel is the place that you're going to send your students to, or you're going to just use it yourself. Okay? So when I click on my channel, it's probably going to look a little different because I've set it up. You can customize it. Okay? So we're missing the inauguration ceremony. Sure, we'll see some highlights. Okay, so what I have is underneath my name, okay, I have browse videos, and then you have feed and comments or something like that. Okay, we, especially with our school account, do not want comments on our video or on our YouTube channel, right? It's not something, we don't really want people to interact. We want to have people come and visit. So there's a couple different ways you can see that mine is set up, that I have uploads, playlists, and my feed. So let's go in and change that channel settings to start with. So up under YouTube, you have this black channel settings. And if we click on channel settings, strangely worded, we click on tabs. Okay? And under tabs, okay, I have like a video unchecked, comment on a video unchecked. I do have it checked that you can add the video to a public playlist. So that means that if somebody came across a video that I made, they could put it on one of their playlists. But if you don't feel comfortable with that, that's fine. I do also want, I do want people to be able to subscribe to my channel. So that, I'm going to keep that, but I do not want channel comments. Okay? No, you don't want people coming on here and telling you about your channel. If they have something to say, if they know their email, your email, they can email you. Okay? Now, also the default tab, we can set to a featured video, a upload, our uploads, or your feed. I'm going to set mine default to feed, okay? And then I don't know if there's a save on this page, but let's just go up to done editing, top right-hand corner, done editing. I do have mine checked. Always take subscribe users to the feed. Yep. Okay, I'm going to click on done editing. There, you can always go back into channel settings and you can change the appearance and you can change something else. But let's actually, let me just see where.
Yeah, we're
on
the subscribe channel.
Info and settings, real quick, if we can add playlists right here.
Nope, that's not where we do it. Okay, so now on your channel, I want to show you just a little bit about your channel. Okay, over here I have, you know, how many video views or subscribers I have. I have the video manager over here on this side, which is if you want to delete videos or things like that. You also have the upload in this space right here. So if you have videos that you want to put onto your channel, upload them to YouTube, that's where you do that there. I'll talk about that in just a little bit, okay? But one of the things that we can do with channels is we can subscribe to other channels, okay? So there are great educational channels out there that are providing educational content for us. And if you subscribe to the channel, it brings you the videos that they put on their webpage or on their YouTube channel. So up in the very top of YouTube, just right here, it's okay, we'll leave our channel. So up in the search bar of YouTube, let's go to TED Ed. So TED. TED Ed. Does everybody know about TED Ed? TED Talks are great 20-minute topics on talking about just kind of the most amazing people and about the topics they're passionate about. But then they've also created TED Ed, which is educational videos by teachers with animation artists. Now look here, look up here, because I'll just tell you what the results look like when you search. First of all, you can barely see it, but you can see how these two videos here have sort of a yellow coloring. Those are ads. They're sponsored videos. So they might still be good, but they are sponsored. So those people are paying to get those to the top. The next one is TED Ed, But you can see it looks a little bit different because TED-Ed is a channel. It's a small box, and it says by TED Education. It's a channel, okay? Other than that, this is a video, but it's by TED-Ed. It's not an actual channel. So when you search, it brings up channel results and video results. So let's click on the TED-Ed channel. So it's the white box, okay? You can click here on channel. You can click here. Really takes you to a lot of the same places. Up on the top of the TED-Ed channel, and we might get a lot of videos playing right now because it automatically does it. But right by the words TED-Ed, you can see there's a subscribe button. And so up on the top, you want to click on subscribe, and then any new TED-Ed video that's brought to you will come to you in your feed on your YouTube video. So subscribing to channels is a really, really good way to be updated on the new content that's out there. TED-Ed is a great one. The other one that's kind of fun is called Smarter Every Day. Yes. Yes. Well, you're not really, when you're subscribing to a channel, you're not posting them on your website. You're just being notified of when they upload videos to their website. But I'll show you when we make playlists, it's like we're adding other videos to our channel. Okay? So here's another example of a channel called Smarter Every Day. And if I click on Smarter Every Day, I can subscribe to that channel. Have this little button right here. And subscribe. This guy's fun. He does really weird science kind of projects and explains them very well. Like the one that's on there right now is how a cat always lands on its feet, and he drops a lot of cats. They always land on their feet. So good little content. Now on the website that I've made for you that I'm not going to bring you to because then it's too much navigating to get back there. But what I have for you on there is all of these YouTube educational channels, okay? So I have YouTube Education, Minute Physics, Black Civil Rights, Medieval Europe, How to Get to Mars, Biggest, Longest, Fastest, which are like planes, trains, things like that, The Infinite Thinking Machine, all these different places that you can get channels. So like the Google Apps for Education has a channel, okay? Lots of different channels that you can do. Sorry, that's mine. Oh gosh. Aww. You can also see, oh, the slow-mo guys are great too. Do you see up on the top how it's done some recommending for me? So the slow-mo guys are really great. So you just kind of want to take a peek at some of those. Here's the Minute Physics guys. Those are fantastic. They just recently had a conference called the EduVidCon, and they brought together all the people that are out there creating content for teachers on YouTube, which is very fun. Now, I want to take you to the next channel I want to take you to, so we're going to go up and stop watching cats. And we're going to search for YouTube teachers. And you're going to look for the channel that's the green chalkboard with YouTube teachers on it. You want to search in YouTube and go to the YouTube teachers channel. Now, the YouTube Teachers site is fantastic because it has educational content on it that you don't have to search for. It also teaches you how you can best use YouTube in the classroom. So there's a gazillion resources on this page if you just scroll down to the underneath. And, of course, they have a much better channel than they're allowing us to have. So why do you use YouTube? How do you get started? But let's click on this classroom videos at the bottom. A couple of you in your pre-survey said, I want to find good content without having to search forever for it? Well, this is your answer here, because over here on the left-hand side, we have different subjects, so language, arts, math, science, social studies, okay? And then let's say you teach elementary math, but you teach middle school, because we're in a middle school, so let's click on that. Underneath, when I click on that little plus sign, all of these, okay, are not channels. If you click on the plus sign for what you teach, any of these blue links are called playlists. Playlists of videos about that topic. So let's say that I was going to teach variables on Monday. If I clicked on variables, oh, invalid parameters, whatever that means. Maybe that playlist is no longer there. Let's do perimeter and area of rectangles. Now, just take a peek up here and I'll show you what a playlist looks like, how it is. This is a YouTube EDU playlist and it has 14 videos, okay, all about the area and perimeter of rectangles. So I have all of these videos here that are all about the area and perimeter of rectangles. Now, teachers have put these together. There are Google certified teachers that are out there vetting content for each of these playlists and adding video to each of these playlists. So you can know that a teacher has watched this video and has added it to this playlist. The bad news is that you used to be able to swipe this entire playlist and put it on your channel. The newest update with YouTube in like November doesn't allow you to do that. But let's say you really, really like this top video, Perimeter Area Song. Okay, I'm going to teach you how to do this and give you like 5 minutes to play after this. If I click on any video on YouTube, now that you have a channel, okay, you can add it to your own playlist. Okay, now you'll see over here, here are all the other 14 videos that are going to be playing within that playlist. And they're going to play one after the other, one after the other. Okay, I don't want it to play. Down underneath the video, okay, I have about, share, and add to. If I click on add to, it's going to talk to me, it's going to show me my playlist. So these are playlists that I've already created. So I could put this perimeter area song in one of the playlists, or I could add a new playlist below, and I'm just going to call it area. I choose whether the playlist is public so other people can see it on my webpage, and then I create the playlist. Once I've created it, you can see now that there's one video in my area link or in my area playlist. So let's go to the next one, area of a rectangle, the next video. And if I want to add that to my playlist, now that the playlist is already created, I click on this little add to button. And now I can add it to my area playlist, and there are two videos there now. So what I want you to do is explore this YouTube Teachers and all the videos that are in maybe your subject area and start at least one or two playlists that you can start adding videos to. Now, if you go to my personal account, you'll even see I have playlists like fun videos to share or funny videos to watch. So you can have those kind of playlists that are like intro videos for the kids, you know, something like that. So I want you to take a little time to create some playlists and add video to them.
So for if I add, it's not in here.
So then you will have to just search for some videos. So like maybe search for education PE videos or something like that. Okay, how's 5 minutes to do some of that? Good?
So I have a question.
Sure.
How do you control the ads to inappropriate videos that show up after a video is completed?
So, ads.
When you got done playing the video, there was some women.
Oh, yeah? That's not okay?
With your fifth grade?
My boys like that.
To be honest, it's more about educating the kids that that might happen. Because there's no real great blocks for it. I have an ad blocker extension, but it doesn't really work.
Wouldn't that get us in trouble? Kids go home and say, oh, we saw this video.
Well, I bet they're searching YouTube videos at home, too, and then hopefully they're not watching it, you know, because you have to have some expectations and consequences for if they actually click on something like that.
But a lot of us, you know, with our kids, and we use it all the time, open for everybody in elementary too, and we just say that they have to quickly, you know, click the X and then come and report it to a teacher that there was maybe something inappropriate on there. But there's no control that you have within that. You can take the video and embed the video without related content at the end. Okay, so that's the only option. Or you can go to a video website like Kick YouTube or Save Vid, and it will actually download the video so that you have the file, and then you can put it anywhere that you want it to as well, so that it's not on YouTube. So, but it is a lot of work.
Once you've added it, then you can edit it.
I just couldn't.
You could take it off of YouTube. I mean, none of it's really that legal though either. Like, you're not really allowed to download a video from YouTube that's not yours or edit videos. But you know, I mean, it's all possible. So you can get the video file by doing like Save Vid or keepvid.com, and then you can bring it into any kind of iMovie, you know, Windows Movie Maker, anything like that. Edit it down. But what happens is after you play a YouTube video, there's just related content that comes up, loosely related, and that's the stuff you can't edit out if you're still using YouTube as the environment. Right? Except for if you grab the embed for the YouTube video or put it on a Google site or something, strip it of the
redaction. I have another question.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that how do you give kids
so we usually put a link to the teacher's channel on their webpage or Edline or Moodle or something. Or we have teachers just link videos, specific videos that they want.
That's after
to
I told like
the Moodle page.
No, I think you should skip your other one and come to lunch with us.
Come on, listen.
I'm sure you should come with us. We'll be downstairs. I'll look for you. I'll even drive you.
Video editor, up in the top right hand corner, video manager.
I'll buy you lunch. I promise.
You can edit
I will.
I'm
sure.
Design.
Huh? You'll see. I got.
Whiskey's water. Subscribe. Look at this. Fish Ed Games has their own.
Nice. Channel.
Yeah, subscribe.
Subscribe and then add them to playlists. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
I don't know. I want to watch.
Jeff's going to put that Neil Ferruccio.
Because I don't have to deal with it.
What?
Neil Ferruccio.
Oh, nice.
Straight ball.
Well, the kids won't. So
it's really good. It's a kid that's 14.
Yeah, I mean, they make
she's coming up.
It's supposed to be.
Things supposed to be nuts here. Peanut butter this morning.
Yeah, and then you can send them to just that list.
The desire for our campaign this morning is an assassination. Whoever this is, some Bulgarian prime minister, and this dude just comes up gunpoint.
And it's gunned in fire.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
It's pretty nuts.
He didn't have one in the chamber.
Okay, that foghorn tells us that our time is up.
Or that a tornado is coming.
You can add your. This is, let me just stop that real quick. So this is a Google Chrome extension that's the timer. It's right in the browser, which is kind of fun. You can add your own YouTube video at the end. Video manager up in the top.
There's headphones in here.
I don't want this on here.
You want to unsubscribe to that then? So you click on the video or click on the channel.
And then click on the where it says subscribed up at the top. Yep. See that little gray box? Does Sky Does Minecraft? Right there. And then just click on that unsubscribe. Now if you go back to your YouTube channel and then refresh. Inside the, yeah. Okay, you guys, just a few navigation things that people have been wondering about is now that you have some playlists, your channel is going to look a little bit different. So if you click on your name up in the top right hand corner and click on My Channel, now you have a little feed here called Playlists. Okay. Some people are asking, now how do I get my students to this? Okay, couple options. First of all, I could link them to my channel, right? So I could just click on my channel and I would give them this URL, youtube.com/userfollowmollyadinah. And I could say, go to my channel and watch this video, okay? But one of the things that you'll probably do is if you go to playlists off of your channel, you'll want to send them to a specific playlist, okay? So these are all my playlists, and I don't like that view. I like the list view, not the grid view. It looks like this better. So here are all my different playlists. So here's my playlist on Area. Here's my playlist on Google Drive. Here's my playlist on Fun Videos. So if I wanted you to learn about Google Drive by watching these playlist, these videos, if I click on the title of my playlist, I would then give my students this link, because this specific link is for my playlist of all my videos. So I could make a link to that off of my Moodle or Edline page by saying, go to this link, watch these three videos, and then that will help you study for your test or something. So there's a couple different ways. You could link them to your channel, you could link them to a playlist, or you could just link them to one specific video that you might want the students to do as well. Okay. We are here till 11. Okay, perfect. So right now, so far, just a little review. We've created a channel. You've learned how you can subscribe to some channels. And then you've learned how to create playlists. So those are really the top three things of helping you to organize your YouTube environment. But there's this whole other side of YouTube that's creating content, right? We don't have a lot of time in the world, so it's great to use other people's content. I mean, PBS content is on YouTube. There's so many things that are on YouTube. We actually are paying for a subscription of something, and the teachers are telling us that there's more on YouTube that they use than we actually pay, you know, a lot of money for. So finding the content that other people are using is really a great thing, but also you can start learning to upload your own video, okay? And let's just watch a little, another, we're in the mood for another video now. So I'm going to have you watch this one real quick. If you have shoes on with laces, take them off and participate.
That part.
Okay, so if I was going to send you home and say, tomorrow you have a test on how to tie your shoes that way, good luck, you'd probably all fail miserably. But if I said, you have a test on this tomorrow, I've posted the video on my website, go home and watch it, rewind it, practice, pause it, you'd all come in and do a lot better. And I really feel like that's the best use of video in the classroom right now, is those little nuggets of direct instruction that you might need time and time and time again. We all have answers to those questions that we know the kids are going to ask, right? You know, it's like you preface everything with, okay, in the past, everybody's asked time and time and time again about this. So creating video based on some of those little nuggets of direct instruction is really going to help the kids benefit if they can access them anytime and anywhere. So part of YouTube is also the ability that you can upload your own video and you can house it on YouTube. So there's a couple different ways that you can create content. One of them that I was talking about was the fact that in the upload feature on your YouTube channel, If you just have, you know, a flip video camera or some, you know, footage from your cell phone or something like that, you can always just search and select a file to upload. Okay? Really easy. You share the settings that you want to put on there and stuff too. But YouTube sub plans or recording, you know, something that you're demonstrating, you could be really great to do a webcam capture. Now, it's not going to work for you guys on those screens because you don't have a webcam associated with them, but I just click record. It asks if it can use my camera once I click start recording. Okay, so I just click start recording and I say, hi kids, today in class you're going to be working on a very special project. You're going to be, you know, using this white piece of paper in order to follow these directions and so on. And then I just click stop recording and I click upload and it's on my YouTube channel. Okay, so that's a really efficient way that you could start creating some little direct instruction nuggets. What if you gave some sort of foreign language spelling test, or some sort of foreign language kind of response that they, you know, you could do some practicing. Anything that you, that the kids might need some auditory to, this might be a great thing for them. Yes, question.
Can you use any external camera to do that? Or just like a flash memory camcorder
yep.
and then record that live?
Yeah, I mean, it'll look for the camera that's associated with your computer. Yeah. So that's a great way, and then you can upload that video, and it goes right onto your YouTube channel. So that's a super efficient way of adding video on there. If you look at the settings, so here are the privacy settings that you can do on YouTube. So you can make it public, which means anybody can see it. It's on your channel. You can choose this video to be unlisted, which means it's on YouTube, but nobody can find it on my channel. I would have to give them the link to the video, or private. Now, the way I've used unlisted is I've done some screencasting or video camcorder responses for students. Think about assessment. What if you did a video feedback to some of the kids around some of the assessment that they've done? So that's something that I did when we had this digital portfolio, is I just created a video of me talking and the students' work up on the screen. I put it on YouTube, but I put it as unlisted, which means nobody could see that video unless they had the link. So I sent that specific link to that kid, and then I got the most incredible feedback from them about, you know, kind of the responses and the feedback that I had given to them. So you can start thinking about some of that with assessment as well. But those are the different sharing settings that you have within there. You can tag them, Edina, you know, you could do uploads. Oh, it already has webcam on there. And then you do the save changes. So uploading video is a great space that you can do that. Now, some people are doing screencasting. Let me show you an example. This is something that we've recently created in Edina. And we call it the E-Academy. Have people been to the Khan Academy? So the Khan Academy is video tutorials on a lot of math and science curriculum. Well, what we decided is that wouldn't it be cool if we had screencasts of Edina curriculum by Edina teachers in that same sort of environment. So this is called the E-Academy. I had about 45 teachers create 7 screencasts about those little nuggets of direct instruction that people really struggle with. So one of those things that our parents struggle a lot with is how to teach lattice multiplication. We as adults did not learn lattice multiplication. So the parents have a really hard time supporting their kids in how to do this. So we have a bunch of different videos now on lattice multiplication. So what the teachers is, they started with like a little PowerPoint intro slide, and then they used either their smart board or some sort of white interactive screen on their computer to create these little 3 to 5 minute videos. Okay, so then it's Jen, and she's in, and she's actually sharing with you how to do that. So this is just an example of screencasting. One of the ones that we use that really has tight integration with YouTube is called Screencast-O-Matic. Okay, you may have to update the Java, so this might be like one of those projects that you do a little later this afternoon, but I'll just show you. So Screencast-O-Matic is a free product. When you get on Screencast-O-Matic and you have an account, you can just click Start Recording. And what Screencast-O-Matic will do is it will create this black and white dot around the outside of your screen, and you just click Record. And it will record anything that you're doing on your screen and your voice as you're talking. Okay? There are other products. So there's Camtasia that you can buy, and ScreenFlow that you can buy, and Jing and Snagit. But Screencast-O-Matic, when you're done recording, it says, do you want to upload it to YouTube? You log into your account, and then it's just up on your site. So Screencast-O-Matic might be a really fun one that you could start playing with to record a couple of those little nuggets of information. And it's one where you want to record what's on your screen, not just your face as the video. Does that make sense, the difference between those two? One of the newest things is this photo slideshow that you can now create on YouTube. So if you want to, I haven't found the ability to narrate over it yet, but it is the ability that if you have a bunch of pictures from a trip or, you know, from working with the buddies or on a field trip or something like that, you could put that together and then put it directly right onto YouTube, which is nice as well. So the uploading allows you to kind of create some of those little nuggets of information, those little direct instruction nuggets that you might want your kids to access sort of for anytime, anywhere learning. Okay? iPads have some great options for screencasting too. So the apps would be Explain Everything, EduCreation, ScreenChop, and Display Record. The one that we use exclusively is Explain Everything. It's not free. But all the other screencasting things host your video on their own site. They don't let you put it on YouTube. So Explain Everything has a good integration with YouTube if that's going to be the environment that you want to use for screencasting. So this is going to be sort of the next section that I'm talking about with kind of flipping your classroom, but I'll just give you a little intro. Is that one of the ways that some teachers are using YouTube is kind of calling it like YouTube homework. So it's not necessarily replacing any content. They're not making any content in their classroom. But what they're doing is they're linking YouTube videos and Google Forms to get feedback from students. So this is an example of this solar flare video that we'll load in just a second, in the way that you could never teach about a solar flare in your classroom in the same way that you could watch a video about it. But then maybe you wanted to get some feedback from students after watching the video, because getting feedback from students is a helpful way for you to sort of change your direct instruction for the day the next day. So after they watch the video, they could then do a couple of responses on a Google form, and then you'd get some feedback as to what they've learned, maybe what they want to learn, maybe some of the things that you might need to review. So this is a little example of just doing, even if you just did YouTube Friday, right, where you had a video and a form and that was part of the learning that the kids had to do. Especially with digital homework, what we do in Edina is we say that it cannot be just overnight because some people don't have access to the computer. Some people, even though they have a computer at home, there are three kids in their family and so they have to share screen time. So we always say like doing a YouTube homework or doing some sort of digital homework is a good thing to have over the period of not just one night, but giving them a little bit of time to do that. Okay, let's pop into one more thing. And I get that you're not doing as much hands-on right now. I apologize for that, but you don't have a webcam to be able to do some recording. When people are creating videos, creating the content, obviously, there's a pretty easy entry level. If you have a webcam, you can just push record, and then your face can be right there. But there is the ability to do some editing on YouTube. So the way that I search for it is YouTube Editor. Pretty hard. And when you're on YouTube Editor, I'll show you what it looks like. What's kind of fun about this is that any of the videos that you create, you can edit, cut out the beginning, cut out the end, add music, things like that. So here's the little video that I did. I'm gonna get rid of this guy because that was last time. Here's the little video that I just recorded in front of you. So I would just drag it down onto my timeline here and I can add some effects, I can add some text.
Just click start recording.
Okay, so you can add some text, you can do...
Just click start recording. Can I say hi?
Okay, and then I would just add that right in there and click save. I could also add a little music to it as well. So I just drag a little music down into it. Maybe I push plus sign. Okay, so now here the music is added to it as well. So now when we push play... Sorry. When we push play up here, what it is it's totally washed out my speaking. So down here on the bottom corner, it says only play the music, or I can have equal talking and equal music, or I can just have the talking, favor the original audio. So now if I have it in the middle and I push play, right? So a super easy way that you could add a little, you know, mellow music to it or kind of fun music if you wanted to do some editing. But the other thing that's sort of interesting is this little CC button in the video manager or in the video editor. These are all videos that have Creative Commons on YouTube. So you can use these videos to edit into your own video. So somebody said they're free to use. So you can just drag down any, and I could search for, I don't know, boat. Maybe I need some video of a boat that I wanted to introduce into my classroom, okay? So you'd have to watch them. This one's 5 minutes and 21 seconds, and they're probably who knows what on there. But you could add those Creative Commons videos to videos that you would want to edit as well. So it's kind of I would never spend very much time on this. I think adding a little title slide and or adding a little music to some of your maybe sub plans or something like that is a pretty quick way, but you gotta give up your Oscar, right? You don't need to have an Oscar performance on any of these videos that you're doing, you just need to do it. Some people get really stuck because it's not perfect. Some people do screencasts like 1,000 times and it's like, all you need is the content in there. You don't teach in front of your kids 1,000 times to get it perfect. Just be yourself, do the teaching and get the content and the resources out there for the kids.
Recommend this as a tool for students who are doing History Day. We have a category called documentaries, and the really techy kids who have the stuff at home use iMovie.
Yes.
And the non-techy kids who want to do it at school have to use Windows Movie Maker, which is somewhat painful. But
yes,
free.
I agree. I agree with you.
Is it even worth exploring? A 10-minute documentary to the best of an eighth grader's ability. They
absolutely could, as long as they create all the footage or they find stuff within the Creative Commons. it allows them to put a slide on, put some music in, and then add their own video. So it's a way that you can do editing. Super simple, easy, not like Windows Movie Maker, and not like, you know, iMovie. So I would say it's possible. I don't know if I would recommend it, but I would definitely say it's possible.
Well, it's less than ideal, but I'm just wondering between Windows Movie Maker and this.
Yeah, this has way limited features, but it will get a job done. Yeah. Yes?
You can add the music. Is there a way that you can add your own comments after you've uploaded just the video?
You can't narrate over it yet. Okay. I'm hoping for that because with the picture slideshow and the narration, we would get rid of photo story.
Okay.
But to this point now, you can't do the narration over anything after. I bet it's not far away, but... it's not here yet. I'm gonna show you one more thing that's kind of cool, and this is a little bit more to do with flipping your classroom. So if you're done and you're at capacity and you're just making playlists, that's great. This is something that's kind of that is useful if you are wanting to do any kind of flip your classroom kinds of things. One of the things that you do when you flip your classroom or when you are using video for some of that direct instruction, sometimes you may ask a question in your video that you want the kids to answer. So a lot of our teachers in the Ecademy would present a problem and they'd say, okay, pause the video, do the problem, and then push play to see the answer. Okay, something like that. Well, when you upload your own videos, so this is the video that I just uploaded. On the video, I can add annotations. Okay, an annotation can be a couple different things. This is how I can link to another video. Hi, kids. So annotations are speech bubbles. So if there's like a topic that I really want them to pay attention to, or if there's a nugget of information or a formula or something that I want to pop up in the video in text, I can just add a speech bubble. I can also link that speech bubble to another video. So I could say, I want you to click right here to find the answer to the question I'm about to pose. So they have to watch the video in order to get the link to click on to go to the next place. One of the other things that's sort of fun is this pause button. So I can add a pause in my video. So I choose where I want that pause to be. So let's say in, you know, this many seconds in, I want to add a pause of 5 seconds. So the video itself is going to pause before it will start playing again. And that's that little annotation that I've done right there. I go up and I click, actually, let me add another annotation so you can see what it looks like. So I'll go to this guy. This is actually not an editor, it's in annotation. So I'll show you how I got here again. But right here, I'm gonna add a speech bubble. And I'm gonna have the speech bubble say, congrats. Or reminder, test on Friday. Not of, but on. Okay, and do you see how down here I could make that little speech bubble link? You can't make it link to like a test or something, unfortunately, or another website. You can only link to another video or YouTube channel. Sort of annoying. Okay, I'm going to save it, and I'm going to republish that video. View my live video here. So let's see how that video is a little different now. Here is where I got to it. When I upload a video, I have annotations. Now look up here in the top corner. See how it paused for 5 seconds?
A very special project. You're going to be, using...
Here's my speech bubble. Reminder test on Friday. So it's just adding little nuggets of stuff that you can add to the video. So you can have it pause, you can link, you can do speech bubbles. So it just adds a few little spices up your videos that you upload yourself as that annotations. In that same space, you also saw that you can add captions, and you can do a captions text file that can add to all of your videos as well. So when you're adding them, you can do those as well. So I would like everybody to, in a new tab, maybe, go back to this page because I want to just show you the resources that I've made for you. So go back to this page, the AKO3Y. And on that page, you can see the second workshop down is YouTube. If you click on those blue words, YouTube, you're going to see all the resources that I have made for you, along with all the YouTube channels that you can subscribe to, playlists that you can steal from. So lots of different resources for you. This is going to be alive as long as it's alive, as long as the internet is alive, okay? So just know that all those resources are there for you. Along with the how to tie your shoes, YouTube homework, screencasting options. And then there's a gazillion things that I didn't get to, which down here we could, you know, kind of talking about more about flipping your classroom. Here's how you do pausing YouTube videos. Turn it some extensions, some other different things that you can do within YouTube as well. Okay. On the main page, I'm going to give you the rest of the time to just sort of play, finish up your YouTube videos, find everything. But on this main page, at the very bottom, there's a post-session evaluation that you must complete before you leave. Any questions or comments? Okay, this has an NFS moment, but it's kind of fun. And we're all adults here. Oh, this is a different one. That's actually a really funny one, though. Have you seen that? Telling your kids that you ate all their Halloween candy? Oh, I haven't seen that one. That's funny. Yeah. I like the one that's like, I just want you to be happy, Mommy.
Is that a flash?
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. dentist. After the dentist. NFS. I'm going to kick his ass. I can't watch that one.
This one?
Yeah. There's a little. Okay, continue on. This one's great, though, too. See, now I'm distracted. I get. I love the YouTube session. Just watch YouTube videos. Do I have another one now, or is it? Oh, what happened? Okay, lunch is next. No. 11 to 12. Oh, yeah. And then 12. What? Yeah. Have you seen this one? Oh.
Yes.
Pardon me for the interruption. This is time for our very first drawing of the day. I have drawn five names. In just a few minutes, I'll announce those names. And the contest will be the first person to find me gets the gift card from Target. And we'll have two more drawings. A number of people have not signed up. So before you leave for lunch or after you leave for lunch, please make sure you sign up where you signed in today. So the following five people can come and look for me and where I'll be. And two hints, I love to see you and I am fishing. So Ms. Gina Ford, Ms. Caroline Swanson, Haley Reinhart, Anita Woodrow, and Nicole Kowalski, come and find me for the gift card.
Anybody in here? No.
I can't believe it. Are you sorry about it? Okay. End of the routine. In the kettle.
The music, right? That's Denver the Guilty Dog.
Denver the Guilty Dog.
Here's another.
Congratulations to Caroline Swanson, who found me up in the second floor by the media center.
Okay.
yourself. That is because you're crazy. Just a feeling, and the new one is much better.
That's a good one if you teach video, right? About perspective and like showing the different feelings and the personification. All right, you guys are out of here once you finish that last one. Lunch is from 11 to 12, and thanks. I can stay around and answer questions if anybody has any. Yeah.
Denver, the guilty dog.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, because the buffet closed. Social studies department's on the line. They're going to Trump's. Yeah, I love that play.
Yeah, I'm now a fan.
Special. Yeah, was it 5 months or something? That was. Yeah. Did we read this? Do you think this makes sense?
I'm going to Michael's. It might be.
How can we reword that? So it's part of the pride.
Let's think about that.
Yeah, I just think it needs to be. I would reword it. She's helping Carla. Oh.
Get anything? I have a question for her.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, good.
Oh, yeah. Hey, there's always new stuff to learn.
Yeah.
I am. Jim took her chair.
Oh.
That's okay. I went and worked on. I had to work on some Google stuff anyway. And it's nice because I can go back in and watch pieces
yeah.
that I miss.
Just a reminder that there will be badminton in the gym today from 11 to 12.
Yeah, you got your attire? Those little knee-high white socks.
The headband.
My badminton's going to be
short, so
my badminton is going to be at Patron. Yeah. Good idea. Hi, Kelly.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
Yeah. Let's see what Noomi's doing. Noomi?
Yeah.
Want to go to Cordoba?
Oh, good.
One year. Nice. 2 years behind. She played basketball. Where have we seen her before? But at home.
She's been around.
Yeah.
She was here a few years ago
at the department. I don't think we've
been. Yeah, she got, I mean, she was. I had all my classes.
And there's no ways that you found you can find
she hasn't been here before.
Now,
no, I don't think
she looks real.
Well, I shouldn't say that. She came to an elementary one. About 5 years ago.
Yeah, that's great.
How did the other Google ones go?
Good. Good, I think. You going to Qdoba?
I think so.
You want to go to Qdoba?
Yeah.
Sure.
And
then I don't care. Wherever.
We can go to Qdoba. Want to go?
I'm going.
Yeah.
I'm going to take Molly and Patron.
Oh, so you're serious?
Instead of functionality, You can now edit and change it. So you push it out.
I love that they can and so they can take from they're just the some HD recorder plus
challenge
and the more they send it up and they can save it in their mind drive. So just
love that.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. Because then it's not another step.
Right.
Or recorder, whatever. But Chrome, what would a lot have?
You know, the only other thing that I can think of is Google Voice, which is a totally different protocol. So Google Voice, did I couldn't remember that the kids can call if they call them versus recording on mirror, and then you were quickly to do like sessions. But it's still it's a worksheet one. So I feel like what you have is
it's
well, to all the kids have
to have no, even right away. It's just a
feeling
like
we're
going to do this.
Because
but
yeah.
I want them to be able to do it.
I tried to upload
the books
and whatever
the library.
Yeah.
And I love and all of the games start and I'm like, the kids are
right
there.
Right there.
Hello?
Yeah.
So it's already quick and teaching and successful.
Yep.
Hello?
So it might just be a computer task.
Okay.
I'm not saying that
she's
it won't
just
get better,
up, so.
But you know, at this point,
like,
I mean, that
hit play as soon as you come into the room, and then you know,
no,
whatever.
That's okay.
Oh, I just
you know,
do the stuff,
process,
you do
so
the stuff that you think, well, I have to do it wrong, because there's no way that it wouldn't allow me
to
actually share the document.
Right.
And then
and get the URL for it.
And it won't actually even play on
yeah, because it doesn't like that kind of file, probably.
What file would it like for an audio?
It likes.
I'm going to buy lunch.
Oh. Are you going to go out and grab something?
Yep.
Okay, I brought something as well because I have three others.
Oh, no.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
Do you ever stick a crew to my plan?
All right.
Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome.
The best PD I've had.
Connie and I
are
going
to go to breakfast.
Yeah. And more of it we'll get.
I have this
we'll
panic moment, though.
Two people.
So
that was so nice.
But I just have this panic moment.